Chair Callender, Vice Chair Gaborone, and members of the Joint Committee on Agency Rule Review. Thank you for the opportunity to testify regarding the proposed rules for the disposal of oil and gas waste in Class 2 in Junction Wells in Ohio. My name is Cathy Cowan Becker. I'm Executive Director of Simply Living, a Columbus nonprofit that promotes sustainability, environmental justice, and our local economy. And we often work with the Ohio Sustainable Business Council, a statewide coalition of businesses committed to local, state, and federal policy that supports a vibrant, just, and sustainable economy. So 8 years ago, the Ohio legislature ordered the state's Department of Natural Resources to come up with administrative rules for how waste from oil and gas facilities would be managed. And this is important because Ohio is a fracking state, and fracking produces millions of gallons of highly toxic wastewater that is disposed of in Class 2 injection wells across the state. So this set of proposed rules before you today is the long-awaited result of that 2013 legislation. So while both Simply Living and OSBC are glad to see regulations of oil and gas waste disposal finally moving forward, we believe these rules need to be significantly strengthened in order to comply with the Ohio Revised Code Section 1509.22, which states that no one should dispose of oil and gas waste in a way that causes or could reasonably be anticipated to cause damage or injury to public health or safety or the environment. So there's five areas where we think these proposed rules need to be strengthened. The first is in lacking information about what is in the wastewater being injected. Fracking companies are not required to disclose what chemicals are in the wastewater, nor do these proposed rules require any sort of testing. And this means that ODNR has no idea what's being injected. Frack waste is often referred to as brine, and these rules call it salt water. But according to the EPA, frack waste is full of toxic chemicals, including radioactive substances, and possibly the forever chemicals under the umbrella of PFAS. So without knowing what's being injected into a given well, the state will be unable to respond to a spill or a release of frack waste. They won't know what kinds of contaminants they're dealing with or how to address it. And accidents and blowouts and injection wells in Ohio have happened before and will happen again. It's not a matter of if, but when. Our second concern has to do with the setbacks. The rules require setbacks of only 100 feet from private drinking wells, surface waters, and wetlands. And this is inadequate for protecting our drinking water and environment. By contrast, in Ohio, a wind turbine must have a minimum setback of 1,125 feet, not from the nearest structure, such as a well, but from the nearest property line. So surely, a frack wastewater injection well, which handles millions of gallons of this toxic waste, should have a setback of at least that much. I think you all have my testimony. Didn't realize I only had 3 minutes, so the other three are lack of enforcement ability, lack of public notice and public participation, and no requirement to cover the cleanup costs and closure in the fiscal analysis. So basically, we think that the whole point of these rules was to comply with the Safe Water Drinking Act, and for all these reasons, we don't think these rules comply with that.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Cowan Becker, can you just cover a little bit more in detail the point that you raised about no public notice or public participation?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So these rules as written do not require any public notice when ODR awards a permit for a Class 2 injection well. The only public notice is when somebody applies. But the applications don't have enough information for somebody to really know anything about the project that's being proposed. And so people are left wondering, well, when is good for a waste injection well be approved near my property? And they have to decide weekly, I'm going to call ODNR and find out, are there any permits being approved near where I'm located? And that's an undue burden to citizens. And also to ODNR, they've got other things to do than to be answering calls from people all over the state wondering if there's a permit for an injection well near their home or their business.
Thank you. Follow up.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for that. And I really appreciate the points of concern that you raised in your testimony. But I'm also curious, you had mentioned that your organization is appreciative of seeing some regulation coming forward since the 2013 legislation. I'm kind of curious, within this package of regulations, of points that might be an improvement over the situation without the rules.
We've had for 8 years, you know, despite passing this legislation back in 2013, no rules whatsoever. So we do want some kind of regulation of frack waste injection wells. We want strong regulations of that, about what's being injected, about the setbacks from the nearest other wells, other drinking water wells, and also wetlands and surface waters. We would like to see a much stronger enforcement ability. The rules is written, and I know, authority to levy fines or close down bad actors. And if you have a habitual bad actor, those people should be able to be closed down for the safety of the Iowans and our environment. And they should also be required to have enough bonds or insurance to cover the cost if there is an accident, or even just when the well is at the end of its life, to close it down and clean it up.
Thank you, Ms. Cowan Becker. I agree with you on those points. I hope, although we need to get some rules in place, I think that they are lacking in many areas, and I hope that ODNR will sit down with folks like you and look over the testimony, so a good amount of testimony that's been submitted with regard to concerns about that the rules are inadequate, and try to resolve some of these